training perspective. And I'll introduce to you Karel, whose talk is entitled Personal Care Giving Services to People with Disabilities and the Older People, Current Trends and Future Directions. And he tells me that that's not quite what he's talking about, but more or less. So I'm going to hand over to Karel.
So we are at the gaming conference. And the project that I'm talking about here is in fact a project that aims to help people to become good personal caregivers for people with disabilities and older people. We have some gaming component in it. That's why we thought it would be interesting to present the project at this conference. That's why it's slightly changed. The last bit is changing. Mobile training with a gaming component. Was still in the works and it's working. Give you a short story about it. As you all know, there are more or less 10-15% of the European population has disability. So that means, sir, a percentage of those people with disabilities need personal caregiving on a daily basis. We estimate that more or less 1% of all people with disabilities really need such personal caregiver on a daily basis. So that means that in fact 450,000 European citizens are in need of a good personal caregiver. Now I'm not fully acquainted with how it is in the UK, but in the rest of Europe there's no really such training for a personal caregiver. It means you get often a refugee, an illegal immigrant, who is going to take care of a person with disability who has no experience whatsoever of how to work with a person with disability. So that means those people in fact get a training on the job. That means they are being trained, how do I lift a person out of a bed who is completely paralyzed? It's not something that they learn somewhere in the school. There is one university degree that you can get here in the UK, but I'm sure none of those that follow a university degree in personal caregiving end up being a personal caregiver. They end up giving advice, but they do not become a personal caregiver. So, older people, and of course people with disabilities, depend highly on such personal caregivers. In fact, they should be of good quality. They should be experienced, or at least have had the proper training. This is not the case in the majority of the cases, as I said before. We did research in a number of countries. We already knew more or less what the situation was. For example, in Greece, I think that almost 100% of the personal caregivers there are illegal immigrants that are working in an illegal, let's say, framework in the economic crisis for very low salaries and basically have no competence whatsoever to carry out the job. Does not mean that they are not good. It means that no one really has helped them to understand how it is to be a good personal caregiver. The same in Belgium. We have rules how you have to employ a personal caregiver. They have no training for what a personal caregiver should be able to do. So we aim to change this in the project. Because there are a variety of skills that a personal caregiver needs. On the one hand, he or she has to be able to take care of a person with disability on a daily basis. That means they can range from cooking, to cleaning, to taking the person out of bed, making sure that the person can go to the toilet. And also important element is interpersonal skills. So these kind of elements is something that we're going to train within the project. So it's not only lifting the person out of bed and putting him in a wheelchair, it's also being having the skills to be able to talk with the person, to understand that the person is in need of psychological support. To give you an idea, so it's a European project. We involve partners from every end of Europe. So of course we have the Belgians, then we have the German partner, then we have the Bulgarian partner, Greek partner, Greeks are everywhere, and then Turkish partner. Turkish partner, important because I wrote the proposal for a Turkish university. The idea was there, that university has very close ties with the Ministry of Welfare and Education and for people with disabilities in Turkey. When
they talk about a small ministry, imagine that ministry deals with millions of individuals. So Turk is huge, over 80 million people, and they have a large impact if they change something. So also there, that ministry has said, we want to take on board what we're going to develop in the project, to deploy it on the spot. Not only going to play in this project, but first of all, the curriculum and the training material. However, do we want to create academic material? Not at all. What we want is very practical training exercises. Very practical examples. So, one of the best examples to show how you should do a certain action or a certain interaction with a person with disability is obviously video, pictures, audio, text. So you're going to do a combination. At least that's what we need to do. Whatever you develop will be available for free. This is something that we have started applying for the past 8 years. And David Brown over there is one of the people that I work a lot with. And we believe that what is developed, money from the taxpayer, should go back to the taxpayer and he should not pay for it. Should be for free. So whatever you're going to develop in this project, what we work on, it's going to be. We're going to also develop a mobile training platform. What have we seen? Many of the current personal caregivers are low skilled. They don't have a lot of background in education. They're not interested to sit in a classroom. They want to see something practical and they can take it wherever they go. So it means they are with the customer, they are, because it's a client, a customer. They face an issue and they want to know on the spot, how am I going to deal with this? Because I actually didn't get the proper training. So that's why we went for a mobile application, which will run even on cheap mobiles. So the person can really open the application, I will show you some screenshots of it, and start interacting. Piping with end users, that's obvious. We do not claim that we are the best, we do not claim that we know everything. It are the users who are going to tell us if you're good or not. This is sometimes forgotten in projects when they say, we're going to test the user. We're not testing the user, the user is testing us. They will tell us whether we did it wrong or not. We're going to do that in Flanders. That's the Dutch-speaking part of Belgium, the biggest part of Belgium. In Bulgaria, in Germany, and in Turkey. Not in Greece, because the park was in place. And anyway, we're going to absolutely provide them a big language. And then we're also going to create a portal where personal caregivers, service providers, people with disabilities will be able to interact and exchange best practices. Because a person with a disability, let's take for example cerebral palsy. You put 10 people with cerebral palsy next to each other, and I ask you to pick up the person who has CP. Not half of them will recognize, because they're totally different. So one disability is never the same. So for that reason, we have seen that the way that personal caregivers should undertake certain action is often very different because of the degree of disability or even within the disability itself, because how people handle their disability. So the idea is that within the portal they are able to submit other practices, good practices, but also the mobile application. So there as well, if they believe this is the way I do it and it's properly done and I like it, they can submit the video, they can submit picture, and it goes into the system. The current kind of training approaches, if there's any, is mostly done through we did, in order to understand the current situation, we contacted PCGs all over Europe, many countries. And we did it through interviews, we did it through focus groups, we did online services. And we asked them actually, how do they do it currently? And how do they like to do it? Now, when we look at training centers, for example, they suggested, oh, we should have practical training, a good environment, online training, etc. So we started summarizing all the things that they say it should be like that. And in reality, it's not. But for example, in Belgium, I know exactly one training which exists for for whatever reason, it's never organized.
Whenever you look on the website, no, it's not. If you're not organized, you don't know what you're doing. So we looked really at what they wanted to do and we wanted to try to bring that together in the project of organization.
What is our flow?
Why do I say this? Because not everyone can become a PCG.
Not everyone can become a personal caregiver.
This is very important. So we have the low skilled job seeker. Now I have to make a comment here.
In many countries, nurses who are studying to become a nurse are also PCGs. So there are people that do their studies and because they want to earn an extra money, they do PCG work. Once you are a nurse, they no longer do. So when I say low skilled, it's not always low skilled job seekers. It's often students that do it, but once they have actually the diploma, they don't do it because the money is not. So in general, we deal with low skilled job seekers.
Does everyone fit?
No.
So that's why that was also common for many of the students. We want to have a pre-assessment.
We want to know, is that person able, is he competent to do the work of the PCG?
If a person says, oh my god, my back hurts all the time, PCG, it's impossible. If you have people that are extremely rude, you cannot do that either. You really have to have a feeling with the person in the speech. You have to have some understanding, some empathy recognition. Next, the step that should follow, that's the optimal step, you should go to what we call a vet center. Vocation education training center
has different wordings in different countries. For example, in Belgium, that as a term does not exist. You have to be
like
a center where you can learn a specific profession without going to university.
So the idea is that once the person is pre-assessed and is approved, he actually is going to follow the training plan, face-to-face online learning. And then of course, face-to-face learning, there's also actually a practice that the person has to go with even with students.
And after that, we do post-assessment. We should check whether that person is able to do the work of this.
Then, optimal solution. He goes to beneficiary. Beneficiary here is a client, person with disability. Can he carry out his work, and whenever he needs extra help, he will take the mobile. So, when we talk with current PCGs, they make the following comments. There is a desire for them to learn anytime, anywhere.
I've said it before.
So that means two things. Mobile, internet connected.
These can be good things, but these can only be restrictions.
So that's why we look at the mobile environment that is affordable, and that can work on the lower.
That's also why we work on
practical examples supported by images, videos, text, audience. Then another element that came up in the questionnaire was that often PCG is confronted with a person with disability who uses assistive technology.
They have support them on a daily basis, but they don't have a clue what is that assistive technology.
So for that, we're going to admit work that we've done in the previous project about assistive technology learning. Some of the people here have technical.
We have to develop it. It cannot always be a nice story, we have to develop the story as well.
So what we thought about, what if a service provider or a person with disabilities or a personal caregiver would be able to submit his own best practices? Or mobile. So that's why we started thinking, okay, let's put what we say a content management system online so that people can submit their information. And the application that you run on your mobile is adjusted as such. So you don't have to reinstall the application, it will automatically pay the new content. Free, if possible.
Yes, we want it to have free.
That's why we work with open source software like WordPress and Android. Let's have a look at the application itself. So we have here a number of languages. The system is such that we can support as many languages as possible. You just add the interface, the flag, and English. So once you have selected your language, I'm going to stay in the English for this moment, you
can decide, okay, I would like to get training in personal caregiving training material, or I would like to be trained on assistive technology information. And often they are interlinked. What do we have? Suppose that you go in one of the options, you always have a wizard application. What is a wizard application? We actually, a wizard application means, based on the number of criteria, I'm going to select that training content that is applicable to you. For example, where do you want to provide assistance? Is it at home? At work? Outdoors? Public environment? What type of assistance do you want to offer? Is it mobility? Is it hygiene? Maybe? What type of disability? So it's a home, it's a visit style, so that people don't have to try to search on the Google. Profile-based search. What does that mean? I register to the system and I say for myself, I am this kind of personal caregiver. I mostly work with people with mobility impairments. People that are paralyzed. So as a result, when I look for information, automatically the system will know, oh, this is the profile of this person. These are the modes that he's most interested. So this is an example again, the profile, you create a profile again using some parameters. Free search, that means I'm doing all kinds of stuff and I actually want to look straight in the text for that for a specific and for example hygiene toilet. So then you can fill it in. Identifies interactions. Favorites. If you know that there are a number of actions that you always carry out, you can favorite it. And then it will show it in a list. So here we put three examples. Using mobile host, we call that a mechanic nurse. It's a very strange thing. How to insert a catheter and support for blind persons. So, for example, how to insert a catheter. There are many ways. Whether it is a male or female or a male patient, depending also whether you have a stone. Submit content. So this one for me, I think this is the strongest point in the application, because this really anyone who's interested to submit their own information. Even more, suppose that you are a care service provider, for example in England, and you would like to have this application operated by the people that work in your institution. You know exactly what you want, you know exactly what is a good practice, you can put it into the system, deploy it for everyone, and everyone in your organization will be able to do it. It's also set up as such that at the end, when you know that, for example, this care service provider is interested, you can literally install the system on their service and they can operate. So here is a demo. So I can submit the title of the because we call it a learning object. It's a learning material. You can submit, you can attach video, you can attach image, you can attach text, of course, you can use links. You select category, and there that means you're going to say it's for person with disability, for the specific Log in the register. Speaks for itself. I don't say the important is here again that on the one hand we have the person caregiver, but we also talk about the care service. This, then another element that we came up with was the gaming feature. Now at this moment we have kept it quite simple. We ask a number of questions based on the good or bad answers. We're going to give them advice, etc. But the system really allows to plug in other games. So if at a certain point we come in with another game that we find interesting, we can plug it into the system and have actually whatever games are engaging for the trainings to play. That's why it's a mobile application with a gaming component. Here for example is how to insert a catheter. So here is a support and video that shows how to insert a catheter. The next thing is it's in the steps of explaining. And then the third one is there are going to be specific questions. Specific questions that explain how many times, for example, should you check for a catheter to be inserted? Every 24 hours, every 8 hours, and depending on your answer, an answer is given, the reply is given whether it's good or bad. And secondly, it will also advise other recommended content that is relevant to you. quite simple at this moment for the year,
but it can be quite complicated.
So, summary and conclusion for this.
I would like to repeat. The target group for us are the low-skilled unemployed people or the personal caregivers.
Of course, existing personal
caregivers are going to improve their skills.
Service providers, it's very important.
The learning anytime, anywhere is far from the survey. That's also why we went for the mobile training. The gaming component is introduced because of automatic engagement. But then it can be extended because, as for the element, it can provide access for the application. Beginning of 2015, we're going to do the first tests for work. We're going to ask feedback from end users for the company. And once everything has been optimized, it will be freely available via Google Play. So you'll just have to look for MCare and it will be available to you. If you're interested further in the project, I put here a number of links. This is also uploaded, it's available for you at this conference. And if you want to contact me personally, these are my contact details. This is the end of my presentation, so if there are any questions, feel free to ask. So this links up with reality. Okay? Yeah. And in Belgium, when we look there for the illegal immigrants, most of them are French speaking. But since we tested in Flanders, we don't have French speaking immigrants there. They are Flemish, they are Dutch speaking. So we don't face that issue. If it were in Brussels, we had another issue.
Yes, French
people do not speak Dutch.
You're talking about the user generated. Is that going to be modelized?
Yeah. So the system is as such that if you have either you use the NCare installation as is, and then we moderate it. But if, for example, your care service provider installed on your server, you're going to moderate it. So once a submission is done, it's actually held within the system. When someone approves it, it's released to the system. It's released on the model. But for the end user, it stays completely transparent. He or she doesn't care. Things can be changed on the spot. You will see immediately into his mobile application. And he can also rate what he thinks of the content. So that we also get that feedback from the end user. Does she like actually the specific training? Is it clear enough? Anyone else? Well, thank you very much.
Refreshments, there's fresh tea, fresh coffee, and then the tour starts at 3:30. I don't know much about the tour, David.
Refreshments tonight, tea and coffee. Nick will tell you all about the tour. We'll perhaps be able to get everyone together from the other room as well, Nick, so you only have to do it once. And that's just the explanation. So tea and coffee first, then gird your lines, the tour. Lots of muscle.